righteous word we're going to use for a thought today, building a home for God. Building a home for God. Past, I preached on building a house for God.
Yes.
And we go back in the Old Testament, which we're there still, we find that David wanted to, but the Lord said, your hands are full of too much blood.
Right.
So it was passed on to his son Solomon to build the house for God.
Amen.
But today we're talking about building a home, a Christian home for God. And a home has to have a foundation.
Yes.
Well,
yes.
You can't build a house that is going to stay and endure without the right foundation.
All right now.
You know, Jesus in Matthew gave us the parable of the man who built his house on sand and on stone.
Yes.
Yes.
Y'all going to pray with me, aren't you? I'm not going to tear it up. You remember now when he built it, the parable was this, that the man who built his house on the sand, which is shifting materials, shifting it, you know, it didn't hold up. It wasn't built on the right foundation. You're going to pray with me, aren't you? But then he moved on and said, but the house, the wise man, because one considered a fool to build a house on sand, but a wise man built his house on stone, and because of that, it withheld and could stand against the turbulence of water, whatever the winds brought, whatever fate brought against it. Wish you had a witness. And we know we have trouble in homes today, amen, right here in the house, probably, but we know around America, amen. And a lot of times, the reason that that trouble is there and can continue to be potentially destructive is because the home is the house is not built on the right foundation. You're going to pray with me, aren't you? Amen. You got marriages that aren't built on the right foundation. And there's trouble in the marriages. I wish you had a witness. You have children in the house that oftentimes it creating problems and confusion or whatever in parents. But if you check, you'll see that they don't have the right foundation. You understand? Individually, as people, even as adults, we build our lives on a lot of things. Amen. And we don't have the right foundation. We should have a witness. The country is in a mess. You know, I don't even want to listen hardly to CNN and the news. I said, well, if I listen to the local news, there's a lot of shooting and killing among our young people. Amen. I think they mentioned 100 and something people that were killed last year, and 75 of those were with our young people. I wish I had a witness. You understand? Some foundation is not solid with our people, but even in the Congress, it's getting so crazy, the Republicans are fighting each other. Amen. On top of, you know, what we're not getting and what we need to get from on the other side. But it speaks to a foundation. This foundation in America was built on materialism and slavery. I wish you had a witness. I know that ain't the right foundation. Amen. And you know what they say, you can get by, but you can't get away. I think it was Malcolm X that said at some point in time, the chickens are going to come home to roost. In essence, the problems that you create that you don't see that go way away and you're getting away with stuff, eventually they're going to come around and they're going to come right back and become your problem. I wish you had a witness. So we're talking about foundations. Well, let's look at that first scriptural area. Amen. Right here you have Moses, amen, talking to them because they were getting ready to go into the promised land. I wish I had a witness. They were getting ready to go into the promised land. And in going into the promised land, they were being reminded, amen, of what had happened. Because you remember, if you go back in Scripture, you'll find that The Lord had told them to go ahead and take the land. And when you follow God, amen, irregardless of the circumstances, you're going to be all right. They had experienced that in coming out of Egypt. But still, they got to the point, based on the report that came, they saw the fruit was magnificent, everything was good, but they got a report that there were some pretty big fellas over there, amen, that they listened to the report and not to the word of God that it came to them to go up and take it, and they balked at it. They said, oh, no, we can't go. When you go against God's will for you now, amen, that's rebellion. That's rebellion. That means you're going to, whatever blessing God had for you for being obedient, you're going to lose it. You understand? So the people, you know the story? They rebelled, and so the Lord said, what? Because of your disobedience, none of you are going to go and get the blessing that I got planned for you. I wish I had a witness. We're talking about building a house and a home for God. Amen. And so it was that, you know, they wandered for 40 years out there.
Yes, they did.
And they died off. He said Joshua and Caleb would be able to go. But now you got a whole bunch of new folks. And they weren't there at the Red Sea, and they didn't know all the things that God had done. But they was ready for them new blessings in the promised land. And the Lord said, hold it. Let's pause for a history lesson. And then you tell them what they need to know before they go over to possess the land. In essence, we got to get a new foundation. It's not a new foundation, but we got some folks who understand what works.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen. You see, we came out of slavery, just came out of Black History Month, but we come out of a tough situation. Endured all of that. God brought us out. We cried out like the children of Israel. In fact, this story is what many of the preachers and the leaders use to inspire the African Americans in America to rise up and do some things and to become followers of Christ. And look what God had done for them. We're in the same situation. He'll do it for us. And so that was our story.
Amen.
But we followed it too closely. Because after we got delivered, amen, as the Bible said, we went a-whoring after other gods too. We left the inner city, all right, and got out in the suburbs, got out in places, and now we don't even know our neighbors. Our neighbors don't even know us.
Yes,
I wish our kids don't have community centers to go and be around people.
Amen.
They don't have all the things that we had to help shape us to be who we are today. They don't have none of that.
Amen.
The children of Israel, amen, had rebelled, and that generation was wiped out. Now there's a new generation, like we have a new generation now. But we let Satan get in, and we thought it was all right. And look at our kids now. They're more dependent on the phone than they are. Amen. I wish I had a witness. Common sense is gone. Told you about that GPS. You keep following that GPS, it'll have you in California. Amen. Keep telling you, and you tell them, go left, turn around, do a U-turn, go left. Hey. I told you, I said, turn that thing off. I said, we'll take it from here, God, to get us where we got to. I wish I had a witness, but that's the reality. That's the reality. He was going to tell them so they wouldn't have to go left. He said, this young generation getting ready to go into the promised land. And in the process, what it takes for them to have a good relationship, a good foundation for their homes, for their lives, that's what he tells them here in this sixth chapter. Let's read it for a second. Amen. When we look down there, he said, therefore here, verse 3, says, hear, O Israel, and be careful to observe it. You see, you got to be serious, premeditated. Be careful to observe. It's like getting a contract. If you don't read all of the fine print, and all the other stuff, maybe, but the fine print may be the one that costs you, you know, X amount of money or whatever pain that comes with it. He says, be careful to observe it, that it may be well with you, that you may multiply greatly as the Lord God of your fathers had promised. That was the plan. God said, boy, I got good things for you. Your children are going to be blessed. Your legacy is going to be blessed. All you have to do is be obedient to me. Okay, but look what it says. Here is the Lord our God. Is the Lord is one. So first, when you start about building your homes, or, you know, or correcting your homes, the first thing you need to make sure that everybody knows is that God is your God, that your house is a house of prayer. Amen. They can't come in there just any kind of way. If you're cussing and fussing, they can't come up in your house because it's God's house. God is number one in your life. On the job, if the supervisor comes wrong, you say, wait a minute, hold it. Calm down. Amen, because I'm a child of the King. So you can't just talk to me that kind of way. I wish you had a witness. The oneness of God, God is over everything in your life. That's what he said. There's not two gods. Contrary to some of the Hollywood movies and everything, the God of thunder, God, no, there's one God who's the God of everything. And that has to be clear in your walk, in your talk, and everybody in your house. That's what Joshua said, as for me and my house. He was speaking for everybody. There wasn't nobody out there that was trying to be something different. That were doubting, because that wasn't going to work. The Bible tells us here, the first important point is, God, the Lord is one. And then look at number two. You see, a problem sometimes, but on that point is, we try to make other folk our God.
No,
you may not call them God, but if guess what? But if you start putting God second, and make them first, then your heart will fool you on that one, because the heart will say you got to have them. I like all them old songs, but them old songs kind of steer you away. The temptation, I love you, and you know, ain't too proud to beg. All that kind of stuff. Well, you know, it sounds good. It could depend on the way. But the reality is, yeah, you should be too proud to beg on something. Because if God's got somebody for you, you ain't got to beg him. I wish I had a witness. Huh? Amen. You ain't got to beg him. They're going to let you know they're going to love the Lord too.
That's right.
Amen. But look what it says right here. It says, you shall love the Lord what? With all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength, with the totality of who you are.
Amen. Amen.
Number one is God in your life.
Amen.
Everything that pertains to God, you honor and respect.
Yes, sir.
You know what I'm saying? That starts to cut stuff out. You see, this is all about the family of God. What was made yesterday so significant, just so the morning was about the family and our house.
Right.
By giving that young lady down there for the orientation and all that, that was family. We went to the birthday party. It was about family.
Amen.
It was about celebrating a member of the family. And a lot of family were there. They come from out of town. Amen. I think it's from Kansas and from, I think, Dayton or Ohio. They're up there to just show some love for a family member.
Amen.
And it was about the church family, because the church family was there representing.
Amen.
Amen. And then that evening, when we left and went to the celebration, the 80th birthday, they had come all the way from St. Louis and Ohio and other places, Kentucky, to celebrate. All about family. All about family. God's concerned about family.
Yes, he is.
Amen. But for a family, the family is the foundation of the home.
Yes,
now, I'll give you a little bit of one of your old favorite singers that came up with that song, A House Is Not a Home. What was it? Thank you. Amen. But he said truth can come in a lot of ways. A house is not a home if there's no love in that rest. And any love won't do, because you can have some houses that got the wrong love up in there. But if it's the love of God, and it expresses itself with everybody in there, guess what? You're going to start to have a unit now. You're going to have a house that's, you know, when you went to grandma's house and big, you couldn't wait to get up in there, but you know the food was good, but food was made with love. And then she going to say, come here, baby, come on and hug you. That was love in action. And you know where Big Mama got her love from? She's up in the church and on her knees talking to God. She knew what love was because love had poured into her, and she poured it into you. I wish I had a witness. You got to love God with all your heart. Can't be ashamed. You can't be out there acting like you don't know on your job. Around your family, certain ones, they got to know up front. Amen. Because they'll respect you for that. They ain't gonna respect you if you don't show and act and walk and talk the way that you're supposed to, that you're somebody who truly loves the Lord. Amen. And not ashamed. Amen. I wish you had a witness. Amen. Two said you gotta love the Lord with everything. Look, we said with all, with your heart, with all your soul, and with your strength. Now you're talking about when you're tired.
Yes.
You ain't got that strength, but you said, what I got, I'm gonna still give to God. You press on for the Lord. God honors that. He's going to renew your strength. I wish I had a renew. He's going to renew it. Amen. You may have to take a long nap. You may have to take your vitamin pills or whatever. But he's going to get you back up. As only he can. He said, these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. Now look at verse 7. Because it brings us right up to now. Amen. Verse 7 tells you, you shall teach them what?
Diligently.
Tell me that again.
Diligently.
That's where we're failing as a people.
All right.
We want the school system to teach us.
Say it,
amen. The school system is not in the business or interesting. We found it's got two different school systems. So Tony, she reminded me, she said the kids aren't learning how to write anymore. Remember we used to get less, they call it
cursive.
I'm talking about, what they're talking about, they ain't learning how to write anymore. You got graded to learn how to write to your name right, because you got to sign documents throughout your life. You understand? But they would think, well, the computer, no. But I guarantee you, they may have told kids in the inner city not to write. But if you go out there in them suburbs and go to mother place, them kids are writing. They can still do the computer. They can say, but they're getting all of the aspects that are needed to be. I wish I had a witness. Telling our kids not to learn how to write their name. But it says they're diligent. We can't expect the system to teach our kids a relationship with God. If we fluffed on the Lord, they're going to fluff on the Lord. If Sunday becomes a day where, hey, boy, you lay back and you just sit back and sleep, they're going to do that too.
It
tells us now our people, America, is moving away. And I heard one guy say, look, the problem getting ready to come up. And if we allow them to say that it's discrimination against gender, amen. Next thing is, you know, that they got the same rights as black folks have. Then it's going to move next to the church. And I said that several years ago. I said, listen, one party, the one that we put all our votes on, they're also in partnership with that movement. But that movement ain't going to have preachers up here preaching that that's not the right lifestyle.
That's right.
That's
right. Yeah.
That's what's headed into the future.
That's right.
In America, we haven't been persecuted for being Christians yet. But if it's doing it in other places around the world, you know it's coming. And if you duck and dodge now, what he said, if you ashamed of me before men, I'll be ashamed of you.
Amen.
That's going to separate the real Christians from the ones who say, well, I'm a Sunday Christian.
Come on,
you know.
Yes, sir.
We have to teach our kids because they're going to have to be able to stand.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. It says here, diligently.
Diligent.
And you don't teach just by word.
Mm. Yes.
You You have to teach by example. And what's important to you has to be important to the kids. And you have to take time. Look what it tells him here. He goes on. He says, you shall teach them diligently to your children and shall, talking about the laws and the statutes of God, and shall talk of them when you sit at your home, when you walk by the way, when you, in all aspects of your life. You wonder why the kids are out there killing and shooting, doing all that, and all the crazy things that you think, how can that be? Because they haven't had anybody to teach them.
All right.
That's it.
Amen.
That's it.
Amen.
Bring it. Have mercy.
They don't know what it is to see a husband and wife together anymore.
Not at all.
Not when 60 to 70% of our kids are being born with a single parent.
Yeah.
I wish I had a witness. I heard this one preacher, I ain't going to mention his name, but he's blasting everybody. He's blasting, boy, he's looking for a fight with everybody. T.D. Jakes, Oprah, everybody. He's looking for it, but he's falling back on the Word of God. Now, on some points, he can stand right there and he may shove. But the one thing that all of us preachers know is that he's using the Word of God to get his punches in. And one of the things he said, the preachers won't preach the truth anymore. They'll preach prosperity preaching.
Yes,
yeah, get money, get wealth. Well, you're in America. You know, you go after it too much and you wound up like the rest of them. P. Diddy's all right. He's in America, and guess what? He's halfway, you understand? We got all the successful people that all messed up because they got everything to mess themselves up with. You know, Richard Pryor, the one used to be one of my favorite crazy comedians. They said at one point he had so much money and had so much cocaine up in there, man, he just shut the door. And for days, for weeks, you couldn't get to him because he gone.
Man.
But if he didn't have the money, guess what? He wouldn't have been that gone.
All right,
you know what I'm saying? Oh, y'all don't hear me today.
Man.
We got to teach our kids so they don't fall into all those traps.
That's right.
He was telling them, y'all going into a promised land where you're going to live in houses, big, beautiful houses that you didn't buy. You're going to eat food that you didn't plant.
Yes,
it's going to be the good life.
Yes.
That's what America promised. It's the good life.
Yes.
But let me tell you, you teach your kids to respect me, to honor me, to bring a person to all the things so they won't get caught up and you won't regret. Because sometimes it can get to the point when it's your child, and guess what? It'll put you right at their throat.
Yes, it will. Come on, say it. Have mercy.
But if you've given them the means to act the way they act,
all right.
Amen, and you put them to the world to pick up all their crazy philosophies, don't be surprised if your kid talking about, well, you know, there's more than one God.
Come on now.
I wish I had a witness.
Yes,
you know. He nailed Oprah Winfrey on that. And they got her on tape. Oprah said, well, there's, I'm a Christian. He said, I can teach somebody. She said, but there's more than one way to God. And he said, oh, no, you canceled out. There's only one way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So there ain't a whole lot of ways. You can try to find and justify a lot of ways, but there ain't a lot of ways. He said, I'm a holy God. So what? You got it. So that means we can work on it, but you better be working on it, but you ain't going to slide by him. Amen. I told one of the boys about teachers, I said, yeah, the teachers will give you a grade because guess what? They still getting paid. You may not know anything, but guess what? You got a grade. That don't mean that do you know something? Well, do you know about God? He's saying make sure your kids, so they won't blow your inheritance. I wish I had a witness. Amen. So they won't mess up what you didn't sacrifice that I've given you.
All right.
Make sure they know.
Yes, sir.
Set a foundation.
Foundation.
So what I have given you will be able to stand in the days that are to come.
Praise
the Lord. Yes. Yes. Praise the Lord. Yes, Lord. The Jews got trapped. The Hebrews got trapped in Egypt. After all that Joseph had done, and the king said, bring them on in, bring everybody in your family. They're going to enjoy what we got. The Bible says a little later on, though, that Pharaoh died. And the Bible says there arose a Pharaoh who knew not Joseph. Didn't know nothing about Joseph. And he said, wait a minute, there's too many of them. And he enslaved them. Well, our children are being raised without knowing what God has done for us. He brought us out of bondage and slavery. Amen. All the heinous things they did to us, how he set us up. They don't know anything about washing clothes and putting them up with clothespin. Amen. They don't know anything about the little garden and everything. Amen. They don't even eat vegetables. You understand? If it ain't lettuce, tomato on a hamburger, they don't know nothing about all the things that were sacrificed. Talking about walking and catching the bus and working, cleaning other folks' house. They don't know nothing about that. All they used to do is ride, and the buses come and pick them up, take them to school. We used to walk blocks to school. I wish I had a witness. But they know about the Jordan tennis shoes. $160. Do you know what our parents would do with $160 back in the day? That was groceries for a month. I wish I had a witness. Well, if they don't know, don't expect them to act. Like, well, you got to teach them. You got to tell them the stories. Take your time, tell them the truth. Let them know how God has blessed our family. That you're enjoying what God has done. And for you, your kids, then you too have to give honor to God. Don't worry about what other people say and other people do, because they ain't going to be with you no way. Amen. All the kids that you know when you graduate from high school, you ain't going to see them again unless you run into them at a game or run into them at the mall or somewhere. You going, but your life belongs to God. And if the folks who sacrificed to bless you because they believed in God and God blessed them, let's not break the chain.
Amen.
I think they had a song that said, "A chain shall not be broken." Amen. He's telling them that here. Amen. You know how long ago that was, but he wanted it to be clear. Teach them diligently, your children, and shall talk with them. And see, we got to talk. Giving them something to play is, that's all right for the moment, but there's got to be some communication about life. That's come, you hear me tell them, you tell me something, I talk with those guys. They don't know the big stuff's getting ready to come. They're getting ready to go to high school. They're going to find out, they mentioned about girls. I got to really school them about girls. No offense, sisters, but that's my job. I got to tell them just because they're smiling in your face. Hey, you don't want to be the marked one. Amen. Them books will get you farther than being in love in high school will. I wish I had a witness. Amen. It may get you before the judge on some child support if you're not careful. I wish I had a witness. If we don't tell them the truth about life, how are they going to know how to handle life? That's the problem. We leave it for them to find out. Boy, you can find out the hard way and the wrong way. We have to teach them diligently the ways of Lord. And they got to know what a holy lifestyle really is. I wish I had a witness.
Amen.
Teach them what it is to be a man of God and a woman of God. I loved it when a sister yesterday said it to all the, you know, and she bore no children, but God had gave her a whole lot of children to raise. And she said, hey, you know, just like Tony mentioned how back in the day in this church, the older women would tell you, say, hey, sister, you need to get that down a little bit. Amen. They tell you that. You may not like it, but guess what? You understood, didn't all bring that down. And she said, yes, she used to tell her, one of her nieces, so boy, that's, you sure too much of my leg. I caught that. And she said, you got to know how to do it.
That's right.
Amen. Because you can do it if you walk before them. They know you love them, and they know when they're wrong, but if nobody's telling them, guess what?
They never know.
Hey, they think that's what the world is doing, and kids will imitate the world quicker than they imitate unless we show them another way.
Amen.
Some folks don't like to talk about their past. But if your pastor's a good teaching point, you better share that.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Give them some real life experiences. Now, this does talk about a time before our time. But there ain't nothing new under the sun. And you got to teach them the real truth about life so they at least will be armed with some living knowledge and wisdom that they can fall back on. But if there's nothing coming out of there, but what the world, well, the world's got such a mixed up, you know, on all concepts now. Amen. You know if the cartoons are messed up, right? You know, crazy commercials are so crazy now. I said, Tony, did you see that? You know, now we're over 60 years. That's a, did you see what they, that's a commercial. Well, how did the kids handle that? And we sit down and talk with a lady who was a teacher who's about to retire from another state, and she mentioned how the kids were. Well, she's just saying what Sister Trotter brings home from school to tell me how the kids. I said, they got way over there too, huh? They're everywhere. Because they're seeing the same stuff, and then now, unfortunately, they're hearing the same stuff.
Yes.
Amen. She said the kids are coming home from school smelling like marijuana. Said backpacks are smelling like marijuana.
Yes.
Well, if they ain't smoking it in school, there's only one place.
Yeah.
The bus driver ain't smoking it. Well, if it folks is buttered at home, and you know they call it, what, a contact high, well, no, you wonder why the kids are all dizzy and wild. Guess what?
Right.
Oh, I wish I had a witness. Hey, hey, it, we can laugh it off a little bit, but it's sad.
It is.
And then she brought to me, she said, they just busted somebody bringing a truckload of marijuana worth $1 million. I said, that ain't nothing. That's just one little truck. It's flooding America.
Yes, it is.
And it's flooding us.
Yes, it is.
Our culture. Yeah. And we playing it off. We plan out. We wonder why our kids aren't functioning like they're supposed to.
Yes.
How can they? And then when they get no church in them, they get no understanding of Christian love. What foundation do they have to build their lives on?
Amen.
Them are homes that will not stand. There were homes that will not stand. Then when I heard of a young brother that gone in and start killing up, we always ask that. I said, was it black? Because that wasn't our way. We're too close to God. We value life too much. It was a rarity of rarities. But when she said, yeah, went and killed the sister, and said, it's one of ours. I said, oh, well, I know there wasn't no foundation right there. What am I saying? What the Lord is telling us here is that we're going to build. Well, let's go over to Psalms at one verse.
Amen.
27. For he was telling them as they were getting ready to go into the new land, and those young people had never seen God in action, and he cautioned them because he said, hey, listen, this is what I did to them in so many words. That's what's going to happen to you if you are disrespectful and disobedient. Okay, when you have 27, it is. Now, the caption in the Bible that was given to me by the Sunday school department, amen. I don't know, it looked like that little part there is wearing off. I don't know what I'm going to do with that. It says this in that one verse. But the caption above says, laboring and prospering with the Lord.
Amen.
I don't know what yours say. You know they put them captions.
Yes.
But mine says, look, laboring and prospering with the Lord. What we're talking about is laboring and prospering with God in our homes.
Yes.
Because the home is the building block of society.
Yes, it is.
Amen.
Amen.
It says, unless the Lord builds the house.
Amen.
Then say everybody else. Now, I know we got some skilled folks here and there. Well, historically, as a people, we came up and we could build anything.
That's right.
We got a generation now that don't know how to cut the grass. But back then, I'm just telling you, you see who's cutting all the grass, don't you, out there? Amen. Our young folks, don't you tell them to start it up? Them boys know how to, because they didn't have a choice. They can start up and run and keep the line straight, but you got kids that don't know how to do that.
That's right.
They ain't never had to, ain't going to. and don't want to, right? Especially on a Sunday, on a Wednesday when it's 90 degrees. Is somebody going to pay $150 for that? Cut that grass. But look what it says here. Well, I'll give you an example. That big brother 2 years ago went out on a snowy day. They left early in the morning, came back, got another. When he finished, you know how much money he had made in one day of shoveling snow? And I tell you, $600. I started to get my shovel. Wait a minute now. Hey, wait a minute. It's like that. But we a lot of older folks can't shovel their snow. Amen. You know, and then guess what? It snowed the next day. We got to teach them our respect and went out and got more, man. I said, keep going, you know. Amen. It says, but unless the Lord build the house, they labor. Marriages, we don't see many marriages anymore. When I was a young preacher, I was doing marriages all the time. People doing it on their lunch hour. Amen. They had to get one. They had to counsel with me, but hey. They're not marrying anymore, but they're trying to build a life. Trying to build a home, and they got to bling, you know, some of them are bling down. They got the cars, they got to all the stuff, man. Designer, hairstyles, clothes. And they ain't got God. I wouldn't give them 5 good years. I did one wedding. It was down at the rotunda in the state office. And money, they found out I didn't have a communion set. Boy, peeled that money off like it was water. Communion set. Everything was up. Opulence. Yes. Of course, you know that marriage didn't last. Even though they've been counseled to take your love and put it before God, keep it before God. Amen. Let God nourish it and strengthen you. Y'all go together to become one in God. Right. And say, I know what to tell them. Yes. I don't just do it to do it because you put money in it. Yes. It's not my, I'm charged to let them know. Yes. Yeah. Amen. They say, to always tell you, well, we are going to church, but y'all going to go together now and grow together. But if you don't do it, amen, you're not letting the Lord build the house. Oftentimes, it's built off of lust, imagery, style, everybody, all the good things. That ain't going to hold a house together. Amen. Babies don't keep a house together. The Bible tells us unless the Lord, unless he's the number one in your life, amen, unless you're willing to walk and be obedient to the statutes that he's put, amen, it's going to be strained. And eventually, in time, it will break.
Yes, it will.
Say, they that labor in vain who build it, unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman says. The summation of it is this. To make our house a home that God wants it to be. That's filled with love, with leadership, with sacrifice, with working together. So that the kids can know that. What they say about kids are most comfortable when everything is consistent.
Come on, say, all right.
They grow together. They grow psychologically better.
Yes.
They even grow physically. Amen. They can adjust to life better when they've had consistency in their life. But if they're over here 1 minute, over there the next minute around these folks, isn't that ain't going to work. It doesn't give them the stability. But now, when we add God into that equation, amen. When they come to church, I wish I had a witness. When they're around loving people, when they see people show love toward each other, when they see the men walk and respect the women, amen. They don't see the men fighting and fussing. When they see the sisters act like sisters, amen. And they're not jealous of each other and petty stuff don't matter. When they see that, let me tell you, they're going to feel pretty good about who they are.
Amen.
I did not know anything about racism because I grew up in solid black neighborhoods. Everything I saw was like School 26, the Christmas Addicts, business people, and in my own home, granddad and them was steady. They were married 67 years. family reunion was so big. When they put them things together, there was so many folks from all over down south. Let me tell you, everything was in order. The kids ate over there. The men ate over there. The women. Hey, listen, I walk like a man. And I'm used to, that's why you see me today. I don't know nothing about no insecurity and fear. They say my mother died when I was 3, and I was a little nervous after that, and they put me with Grandma. And Grandma was a staunch. She's like you. Amen. Love the Lord. We're going to church every Sunday.
Right.
I was comfortable. I grew up jumping out every day looking good with my brother and sister. We didn't know nothing about white folks.
Yeah, right.
We didn't know anything about fear.
Yes, sir.
The people in the neighborhood, everybody knew everybody.
Oh, yes.
Listen, that made you strong and confident and comfortable.
Yes.
That's what we had coming up.
Right.
Y'all had it down in Mississippi?
Yes.
Y'all had it?
Yes.
They don't have it now.
Right.
The church is the last place they're going to find it.
That's it. Amen.
We got to make sure that we make this church a loving place.
Amen.
I wish I had a witness.
Amen.
They can see real men and real women loving God and loving each other.
Yes.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen. We can be there. It says take a village to raise it. Well, we can be the village.
All right.
And we can give the foundation.
Amen.
Amen. They can grow and feel good about who they are.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
And then we can give them the knowledge that God is with you.
Yes. He is with
when they leave us, whether they go to Bloomington or they go any part of the world,
yes.
Amen, they don't hang their head for nobody.
Come on, Pastor.
Amen. They get in the jam. They know to talk to the Lord about that.
Amen.
And have faith in the Lord. We'll see you through.
Yes, he will.
Then they can pick up the phone and call us, and we can go into prayer for them and make sure that they ain't by themselves.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
That's what a church family is supposed to be about.
Amen.
A church home. That's what our homes are supposed to be about.
Yes, Lord.
Like the prodigal son, his dad said, hey, they said the boy's out there.
Yes, sir.
He said, kill a fatted calf.
Yeah.
Get a robe out there. Took off his ring, put that ring on him.
Yeah.
Bring him on in.
That's
what God is telling us. No matter where you're at, what you're doing, we can get your house together.
Yes.
Come on to me. Bring it to me.
Yes.
Acknowledge me.
Yes.
Make me number one.
Yes.
And I'll see that you'll be taken care of in your house.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
We want our homes to be solid and have a solid foundation.
Yes.
That's what the Word of God is telling us today.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Make him number one.
Make him number one.
Amen.
Amen.
Have no other gods before him. Don't make any. That's in human form or any other form.
Yes.
Amen. Take your kids, your grandkids up under the wing. Yes. Change the dynamic.
Yes.
You got to change the dynamic.
Yes.
I'll leave you with another Rocky story. And y'all know that little dog, he's a Jack Russell. They tell you up front, they hard-headed.
Yes, they are.
Amen. We let Rocky get comfortable. He could go in the boys' room and lay down and feel pretty good. Man, one time I came in, he didn't even get up. He just raised his head up. Yeah, hey, how you doing? Lay back down. We said, no, that ain't going to work. Caught Rocky raising his leg up in there one time. Said he got to come out of there.
Yes,
so Rocky, he'll go and sit in there outside their door, hoping they'll let him. But time to go downstairs. I said, come on, let's go. He wanted to go that way. I said, come on, we're going this way. Now, guess what?
Yes, sir.
Rocky come out, he know I'm headed toward the cage because
yes.
Ain't no break up in here.
Amen.
Had to change the routine and let him know that ain't going to work up in here. I wish I had a witness.
Amen.
You let the kids know that ain't going to work up in here.
Right.
Hey, it's your way or no way.
Right.
The old folks say, when you get your house, then you do what you want, but you in my house.
Yes, yes, sir. All right now. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I can't hit you with this one before I go. I know there's some things in God's house. And y'all know when I hit you with it, step on your toes.
Yeah.
You know, he sometimes even hurts your feelings, is it? But know this. And I heard one preacher say this. There really isn't any church hurt. We use that term, and I won't use it anymore. Church ain't hurt nobody. Somebody as a person may have, even the pastor may have. And you may take it personal, but it's not meant to be. But you can get over hurt if it means that you're going to walk and you're going to experience what God wants you to experience.
All right.
Are you with me?
Amen.
Kids will get over it. Rocky got over it. He's still wagging his tail when he comes out of that cage. Okay, you'd have freed me, yeah.
Amen.
Well, God gets on us.
Yes.
The Bible says he chastises those who he loves. That doesn't mean he's going to stop blessing you.
All right.
When you're wrong, he's going to still bless you. Bible says he reigns on the just as well as the unjust. So you know he got us covered. They get some, but hey, they ain't going to keep getting theirs, but we're going to keep getting ours. Amen. On in the glory. You understand? And so just know that as we try to shape our family, make this church, I'm not interested in having 2,000 people. Amen. But we got to have a good, tight unit up in here.
Amen.
Am I right about it?
Amen.
Love everybody. You got to love everybody. Amen. Amen. We make God's house. It has to be the foundation of his love.
Yes, sir.
And the blessings that come down to our children.
Yes, sir.
And we teach our children to teach them right.
Yes.
Walk before them right.
Walk before.
Guess what? We'll start making strong men and women. Strong men and women.
Yes, sir.
When we start doing that, our kids and our grandkids and our great-grandkids, because some of you are at that stage now.
Yes.
Amen. We're not doing it just for ourselves. We're doing it for those that are to come behind us.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
That's why I salute that sister back there. So those are her great-grandkids. You know, you can forget about the great-grandkids sometime because you're dealing with the grandkids. And then sometimes you're still dealing with your kids that you raised.
That's right.
Now my grandfather told me, he said, I raised you once. Well, sometimes you got to raise them twice.
All right.
But guess what? The rules don't change.
I know.
Amen.
Amen.
The Lord said, I'm the Lord.
Yeah.
I don't change.
Yeah.
Building a home for God.
Yeah.
Amen. Make sure you do those three things.
Yeah.
Amen. And that'll start to lay a strong foundation for God to bless you and your family. And you will bless our church. Amen. Strong families are the building blocks of society.
Yes, it is.
But it is the foundation of the church.
All right.
Amen. God bless you.
Amen.
I pray something was said that encouraged you this morning. Doors of the church are open.